Why don't we get started here? And I'll just say this. So you did your undergrad work at MKU. You're one of our proud alumni. And then you did your MFA at UC, correct?
Correct.
In drawing and painting, right?
Mm-hmm.
Fantastic. Okay.
Yeah, they call it 2D studies.
2D studies now. Fantastic. Mm-hmm. So why don't we get started here. So Tia, why don't you come and, if you will, start asking your questions.
So your work seems to be preoccupied with the spaces we inhabit, the materials and meaning we fill those spaces with. Kind of the thing that I thought of when I looked at it, not that I'm implying that you have a mental illness, but like hoarders and that like conglomeration of all these materials and objects. So that kind of makes them unable to throw away or organize their possessions, and it pairs like their value judgment on them. When you curate items for your work, do you consciously seek out furniture and other functional items, or is this selection instinctual and personal to your own value system regarding important material possessions? And then kind of what I'm getting at is there a story you want to tell before you set out to gather these items, or do you pick the items first and craft a narrative around them?
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, that's a lot.
Yeah, that's okay. So my answer will probably be a little bit roundabout. I grew up there in Northern Kentucky in Independence, and we lived on a small 2.5 acres, but kind of in the country. And my parents were definitely not clinical hoarders, but they saved everything. So I grew up in an environment that was filled with stuff. My mother collected dolls and all kinds of little figurines, and my father saved pretty much anything, like rusty bolts and nails. He had a whole shed just full of rusty metal parts, organized, but you know, like this kind of weird, like save everything, collect stuff. And I think that obviously that stuff affected me growing up. It's ingrained in my history. Although my life right now is really minimal and clean and organized. So when I'm looking for objects for these pieces, I'm definitely thinking back to my childhood. These things are personal memories that I have. So if I'm, what I often do is I'll drive around and look for furniture and other items on the side of the road or a large trash day. And I will, you know, specifically pick only the things that feel authentic to me. And so these are things that either relate to my childhood, like through memory, or, you know, sometimes there's this whole thing about how objects are imbued with meaning, right? Like we as humans, we put meaning onto all types of objects, objects that really don't have much value. For instance, I think the most obvious example is like when a loved one dies or some, you know, your parents might have collected something from their grandparents. Those types of things, like it might be a hat or a pipe or a book. It's like those things on their own don't really mean anything or don't have a lot of value. But the thing that matters is that there's this memory attached to them. So I have this idea about, you know, there's man-made objects and then there's artifacts. And artifacts are these things that are imbued with meaning, which is related to either memory or, you know, it's like when you take a characteristic of a particular person and put it on that object. So I guess what I'm saying is there's definitely a reason for every object that I pick up. It's not random. Although sometimes when I go and do an installation, I'm in a location that I don't know, and I kind of do have to really pilfer and find as much as I can, and I don't have a lot of choices sometimes. So sometimes I'll use whatever I can get.
Intelligent way to get a clear message. future. So basically my question is, were there other artists that inspired you to do that, or was that more your own conclusion?
So, you know, you guys, I went through that same program, and I'm sure it's changed since I've been there, but so the way I understand it is, you know, you have to take everything, right? You still take painting, drawing, sculpture, ceramics,
right.
Photography, right? So, you know, I think that that is really the foundation of, you know, why I was open to at least working in 2D and 3D and even video and installation, like things that are interactive with the viewer. So I think I had an inclination towards that already. Plus, I was a theater major, and I was in costume design, and I was a dance minor. I mean, I had all these things going on. And I think that I honestly just wanted to take all my interests and combine them together. But when I was an undergrad, I didn't actually know that that was okay. Like, there weren't a lot of examples of artists that were doing 2D, 3D, 4D, you know, all at the same time, all about the same content. And I came across, actually, it was Tim Hawkinson. He had a show called Humongolous. It's Humongolous. Humongolous. And at the Contemporary Arts Center in Cincinnati. And it just totally blew me away. So if you guys are interested in the figure, at least, I would look him up. He does drawing, he does sculpture, he does painting. He was making, the whole premise of his show was that he was making self-portraits out of every possible medium and style. So he had a physical, like, sculptural self-portrait made out of belts, like the belts were wrapping around, you know, this sort of hollow hanging figure. He had these beautiful detailed drawings of, like, if you took all of his skin and laid it flat. So he had these really bizarre drawings of skin. And then he had these inflatable latex pieces where he actually cast his body in latex, reversed it, like peeled it off, and then sealed it and made these giant balloons of his body. And he's done that technique for a lot of other things. So he definitely is the first person I saw that kind of gave me permission to say, yeah, there's no reason why you have to be a painter or a drawer or a sculptor, like just like a silo, that you can do all of these different types of things. And I would say my other top three people, number one would be Kara Walker, who has that amazing show right now. It has a lot of articles written about it, so you guys should look that up if you don't know her work. Of course, she uses drawings and silhouettes and animation and video. William Kentridge is another one of my favorites. And I'm sure you guys have heard of him because he specifically uses drawing as an animation tool, but does other things as well. He uses puppetry techniques, and I saw a solo show of both of them at the Fort Worth Modern that was amazing. And my other favorite person, Kerry James Marshall, who's very different, but he's also an African-American artist, like Kara Walker. And he has an amazing show that's traveling around the U.S. right now. So you can also find a lot of information on him. Is that good?
Yeah, thank you.
That's excellent. So we can say to some degree that you are, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, to a great degree, you're a combination of a lot of things, but also at heart maybe a conceptual artist too as well.
Sure, right. I mean, the idea is that you have an idea, I guess. You have a clear concept, and then you figure out what the best material is to make that idea, right?
Go for it.
So mine is a really short question,
okay.
But the answer may be long. So can you say you have found your style now, or are you still looking for it?
Interesting question. because I think style is a thing that I've always had opposition to, but I know that I actually, if you look at my work, I think that you can tell there is some feeling of a style, but it's not a style like you would think of, like if you had an illustrator, you would clearly know what their style is, right? I think that style is something that happens accidentally, and not, I don't even mean that it's not intentional, but just that when you have a studio practice and you're making a lot of work over a long period of time, so right now, like if you look at my website, everything is in the last 12 to 15 years of the work that's on that. So like looking, if you looked at just one or two projects, you might think like that looks like a completely different artist, but when you start to see all the work together, it starts to make sense. And in the way that my work makes sense, it's more conceptual, like, but there are some aesthetic things too, like within the drawings themselves. But I think that's a good question. I think that style is something that you shouldn't really try to pursue. I think it's something that you naturally develop over time. But that's just my personal opinion.
Yeah, go ahead. You can sit right there. Just speak up really loud. You're good to go. All right.
Hello. So my question is more about your technical choices for certain pieces of yours. But I've noticed that some of your larger images were drawn on multiple pieces of paper and then combined and layered on top of each other to make one large image. And I just want to know, what was your reason behind doing this as opposed to using one large piece of paper like you did with a lot of your other pieces of the same scale?
Sure. I think that the main reason I started using multiples was because I really wanted to do not the work that you're talking about exactly, but I was doing a lot of work where I would make a lot of small drawings, so they're all individual drawings, and then they would be grouped together into a larger mass. And so that work is kind of where it started. I was doing a lot of documentary drawings of storms. So I was doing drawings of communities before, during, and after storms, which is pretty relevant to what's going on right now. And I was taking those and grouping them together. By grouping them together, I was trying to show how massive the impact was to all of these different individual people. And I'm interested in this idea of like community. And so doing a lot of appropriating and hand drawing things to me is a way to kind of memorialize these events. Now, I think that that is a different body of work than what you're referring to exactly, but you can see how like doing these small multiple drawings could turn into like larger, you know, multiple sheets of paper that's layered. Actually, when I was an undergrad, I learned a technique of using lithocrayon on drafting film, which is coated mylar. And so I was doing a lot of drawings actually at the time at NKU, where I was layering sheets of mylar to get different effects, usually mostly the figure. So I just, a couple years ago, went back to that material. So it's slightly translucent, you can see through it a bit. And the other thing is, some of those works, they're very chaotic. So a lot of them will be like balls of junk, like piles of stuff, right? And the grid that's created by the multiple sheets of paper acts as a container of sorts. It creates like a system that is geometric on top of this really chaotic, organic, you know, sort of floating shape. So I think that that's part of it too. Some things are accidental, some things are definitely on purpose, right? Like you fall into something that is familiar. So like a material you want to work with. At other times it's problem solving, it's practical. So I want to make a piece that's 12 feet by 12 feet, but the material that I have is only 3 foot wide. So how do I creatively, you know, kind of solve this problem? Do I only work in a 3-foot square? For me, it's a definite no. Like, I will try to, you know, figure out some way to make my ideal, you know, what it needs to be. And sometimes I will work on like 9-foot, you know, wide canvas or whatever. So it just depends on the project. I don't know if that's a good answer. So my work, like my work time, how I split it up?
Yeah.
So as you guys know, I think you know that I am a professor, and actually I'm the chair of a department, of an art department of a university. So unfortunately I have a real, I call it the real job, right? I mean, it's good because it pays my bills. I have a real job that's great. I love it. In fact, I love teaching. But it really puts a damper on my studio time, like it really limits it. And I'm sure Mark can tell you.
Yes, I can, 100%.
And you seem like way more productive, or more hours in the studio than me.
I was gonna say just the opposite, actually, of you. I'm jealous of you.
Well, listen, you know, the thing that I do is, you know, it's similar to having a deadline. Like, you have a project coming up, and you have, like, a week or two to, like, get this big project done for your class. That's kind of like how I live my life. I run my studio very, very project-based. So I have, you know, currently I have 6 upcoming exhibitions between end of September, or mid-September actually, I have installing one next week, till the end of November. So 6 shows, which is really too much. Luckily, some of those shows, it's existing work, so all I have to do is coordinate, like, okay, what do I need to, you know, send to this show? You know, I'm gonna have to pack it up, I'm gonna have to ship it, all those practical things. So I spend a lot of time just organizing and making sure that I have everything I need for these different exhibitions. And most of them are out of town, so I'm usually flying to a location and shipping my work. Some of the shows are completely new work. So, you know, I just work on the weekends, I work at night, just like you guys. You know, when you're not in class, you're trying to get your work done. It's difficult, it's really difficult. But I do think that, you know, someday I would like to maybe not have a job and let my job be my professional artistic career, which I also see as a job. But right now it is definitely secondary to my work life. But I do keep a rigorous schedule. I mean, I do produce a lot of work. It's a little bit intense.
You do. It is intense for sure. Yeah. And also congratulations are in order for your winning of the, I think it's a grand prize for the Dave Brown Projects, correct?
Yeah, thank you.
You bet. It's very competitive. Congratulations. It's fantastic. So, Kat, do you have another question?
Oh, these are the tough questions.
So, it seems like your drawings and sculptures are often reflections of each other. I was wondering which one comes first, and do you create your sculptures or your drawings first?
I don't really have a particular order, although I was always working in drawing prior to the three-dimensional works. So the 3D works definitely come out of my interest in drawing. You know, sometimes people think that I build a sculpture, like you would make a still life and then draw from it, which I've never done. So it's not that logical, and I think that the drawings and the sculptures happen, you know, sometimes they are really cohesive, like what I'm making in the drawing is really the idea for the sculpture, like when you're, you know, sketching up something, you know, to be built three-dimensionally, in a traditional sense. But often the 3D work, which is really installation-based, I think of as spatial drawing. So, I mean, I definitely think of myself as a drawing person. I think it's a really awkward title, but I think that, you know how you guys usually pick one area or another. So you might be more inclined to painting, or you might be more inclined to photography or ceramics. So I think of myself as a 2D thinker. Even though I'm using three-dimensional space and 3D objects, I still kind of think of it as putting together a composition, right? But just it happens to be in space instead of on paper. But yeah, the 3D and the 2D, they don't in particular have one, you know, like a particular order that they happen. And often the 3D happens on its own as a separate kind of illustration of something. Is that good?
That's fantastic. Fantastic. So we've got another question coming.
Hi, do you create work with the intention of staking socio-political relevance? And how has the subject of police brutality impacted you personally? And if not, specifically regarding the installation, Domestic Brutality.
So your latest, one of the latest works, she's asking you about, I guess, police brutality and how it's affecting you.
Yeah, I wanted to say some things first about this idea of social political relevance, and I think that and I get myself into trouble sometimes, but I really do think that it's an artist obligation, artists and designers, to take a stand and to, I would even say, to be change agents. So, and I work at a liberal arts university that is social justice oriented, and I don't know if you guys are familiar with that, but it's a Catholic institution at its core. So, you know, a lot of our discussions that we have here is like, what is the role of the artist in society? What are the things that we can contribute? It's not just about making ourselves happy, but I think once you put your work into the public realm, you start to have a responsibility to think about like what's going on in the world. Now that, and I don't mean to say that everyone has to have a social political, bent to their work. I just believe you have to be responsible and at least think about it. Like, what do you want to say? How is your work actually making a difference? And I'm talking again about people that are making work, that are showing it in public. Like there's definitely a sense of responsibility to being an artist or a designer. And sometimes it's not this heavy. It's just like, hey, I wanna, you know, kind of beautify something, improve something. I want to critique something, right? Critiquing the world is kind of a thing that I feel like I do. So that's sort of the base of it. In regards to the domestic brutality pieces, obviously I think we think of police brutality as mainly affecting the poor and minority groups, right? And you guys remember, you guys probably don't remember, but you know about the Rodney King beatings, right, by the LAPD.
I do. So, I lived in LA at the time. They probably don't, but I do. Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
I mean, not awesome, but
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, I remember. Oh, yeah. I remember the whole OJ stuff, too. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so I was at NKU when I was a student. I was living in Over the Rhine during the Rodney King incident. This was 1991, and It was the first time that I actually was confronted with this idea of white privilege, which we weren't even using that terminology back then. And the stuff's kind of heavy. But it was the first time that I realized being kind of the only white girl in my little neighborhood. I lived in Findlay Market Square, and I had a lot of amazing neighbors, but I really, when the Rodney King thing happened, people were very upset. I mean, people were, like, even in Cincinnati, we were on the verge of riots, although that didn't happen. And it made me, you know, really question our government. I honestly, I couldn't believe that this was something that happened. And the thing that really upsets me is it's still happening, you know, and that was 1991. In 2001, Timothy Thomas, you guys, have you heard of Timothy Thomas? So he was a 19-year-old who was shot by a Cincinnati police officer, shot and killed in an alley he was running away from him, I think. And that actually caused the Cincinnati riots of 2001. I don't know if you guys have heard of this stuff, but you should look it up. So again, I was living in Over the Rhine on Vine Street during this time, and you know, every time something happened, I would just be like, what is going on? Like, how is this even possible? And it just seems like police brutality has gotten worse, and probably the thing is we know about more of it now, right? Because we have cell phones and there's a lot more documentation. So needless to say, like, obviously, I'm not African American, and the major population that's affected by these things is that population right now, and it's definitely about racism. It's not about, you know, who are criminals or not, or who are poor or not, or who's in the wrong place at the wrong time. There's definitely racial profiling that exists in our country. It's not an excuse, you know. I think still people are like, well, you're a white lady. You're a white woman who is middle class. Like, I grew up poor, but, you know, it's not the same kind of thing. But my husband's African American, and I'm not trying to use that as an excuse either. But I've lived through him being pulled over, you know, 10 times to me being pulled over once, like driving his car. So I know that these things are real problems that we're having to deal with. Now the reason that work specifically is addressed through this decorative format is because I'm trying to take ownership of how whites in America have, basically it's like we're not doing enough. Like, it's ingrained so much in our society that we don't even notice it. So when you're thinking about, you know, these things that are going on and we kind of just keep going on with our lives, it's, you know, you may feel that way because you can't personally do something. But I think as artists, these are ways that we can stand up and talk about the things that matter. But you have to do it with, you have to be very careful. You can't just appropriate culture. You can't just say whatever you want. It's a really heavy situation. So I think, you know, when you look at the work, it looks decorative, and it's definitely on purpose. You guys know what the piece that she's talking about?
Yes, yeah.
Okay. So in the gallery, what happens is you see this beautiful, like, toile pattern wallpaper in this color, and there are lots of things in the piece. There's obviously the black and blue metaphor with the colors. I've been blackening objects a lot, which is definitely related to race. You're drawn into the piece because it's really lovely from a distance, but as you get closer and closer, then it starts kind of slamming you in the face. So anyway, I don't know. I could stop talking about it right now, unless you guys have other questions.
Yeah, we do. Jessica, you have a question?
Hello. Hey, So my question is, after graduating from NKU with your BFA degree in drawing, what was going through your mind about your future, and how did you plan or decide on where you're going to go next, or how you're going to make that next step? I'll be graduating pretty soon with a BFA in drawing, so I'm kind of curious on where to go next, or how you decided to do that.
Yeah, so I'll tell you, I dropped out of school for a couple of years before I finished my undergraduate degree, which in a way was the best thing I ever did. You know, it related to like boys and stuff like that. But it gave me a little bit of time to figure out what I wanted to do with my life. Because like I said, I had a lot of interests. I was a theater major, I was a dance minor. I actually sang in the choir. I was an art major. I started as a design major, but quickly switched to art. That was one thing I figured out. I was a math tutor when I was a freshman at NKU. I mean, I had a lot of things I was interested in. So I needed a little bit of time and space to kind of figure out what I wanted to do with my life. And somehow through traveling and meeting people, you know, the thing that stuck out to me were the mentors that I had, the people that really impressed me the most. And one of them happened to be one of my professors at NKU, who actually doesn't work there anymore, but he really inspired me. And, you know, I thought, you know, I really want to do what he does. I want to teach at the college level. So that was a very clear agenda that I had. Which has a very clear path. So like college teaching, you have to go to graduate school, you have to get a master's degree, you have to teach a lot, you have to have a lot of experience, and eventually, you know, you can probably get a job.
And I would say you also have to be an excellent practicing artist as well.
Sure, yeah.
Yeah.
It's kind of being like Superman.
You have to be a great juggler, would you say?
And I, you know, it's the hustle, right? You guys hear the terminology, like doing the art hustle.
Right, right. It totally is.
Go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
You have to take any and all opportunities that come towards you. So that would be my number one advice. You know, you're going to get hit up for some stuff. You might need to go look for some stuff, but, you know, when someone says, hey, you know, can you help me paint this mural on the side of my business for less money than it's worth? Sometimes you say, sure, because I want to put that on my resume. Sometimes you say, no, I can't do that because I don't have the time and energy, you know, and I don't want to be undersold. But honestly, the more stuff you do to get experience, the better your resume is, the more real jobs you're going to get from that. And this is a sticky problem, you know, like, I think that artists should have internships just like designers do. I don't know if you guys have a required internship for art now, do you?
We don't yet, but we're as faculty, we're in discussions to try to make that happen.
Yeah, you need, you know, people in design are really much better about it. Like they want
right,
internships
right.
that are paid, not just volunteer service.
Right.
But I think that this is a sticky point. Like for artists, like you have to realize that in general, you are the lower class citizen in this country. Like when it comes to professions, you have to work harder than anybody else to make a living. You have to really fight for everything.
You do. Yeah, I totally agree. Yeah.
But I think you have to do your time as well. I think doing a couple internships for free is good experience. Just think of all the stuff that you're getting. You know, like if you're working with a professional artist, think of all, you know, the advice and technical stuff you could get from that person. So you have to kind of figure out a way to do some stuff on the side and still be able to pay your bills and not feel like you're selling out your soul.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right.
So we have a couple more questions, Cooper.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So how could you or like us push ourselves in a competitive art world saturated by so many styles, designs, ideas, when it seems like the rest of society doesn't really care about artists.
Right.
That's
like
a nice
segue
there.
How do we distinguish ourselves? I think that, I do think it's an important just thing to know. You know, I think a lot of artists don't realize that they really need to be aware of what's going on in the contemporary art world, in the contemporary world in general, right? Like style. If you look at Pinterest, like you see every possible, you know, thing that could be on there, every type of artwork. If you look at illustration today, you see all of these amazing people. So is there any room for us, right? Is there any room kind of in the market? And you do need to be aware of it. At the same time, you can't let that limit you from just making work, because the thing you have to do first is just have a studio practice. You have to make work that you're interested in and that you can make a lot of and that you can do over a long period of time without sort of kind of sticking to something. Are you guys still there?
Yeah, we're there.
Okay.
Yeah.
My picture got paused.
Yeah.
If you don't stick to something and kind of work through it, like you're really never going to get ahead. You know what I mean? So
there we are.
So I don't really have a good answer. It's just that you have to be aware that it's an issue. Like you do want to define yourself. You want to figure out, you know, that maybe this goes back to the idea of style. But I don't think you should pursue style. I think you should be educated about what's going on around you so you can make, you know, smart decisions about your work. But the main thing is you just have to make work. And you can't just leave it in your apartment. You have to show it to people. You know, you have to actually be engaged in the community, you know, and do some local shows and stuff.
I think we have time for one more question, okay?
Okay.
So I also work in a larger scale, or I'm trying to. My question is more technical. I was wondering how, in some of your works, do you start your process of like fleshing out your ideas? Like, do you have a definite idea, like a concrete idea, or do you let your work kind of change as you're working? Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think that I work in all different ways, but I'm trying to think back. So sometimes I always have a theme that I'm working with. Like when I just did this recent body of work, the domestic brutality work, I honestly wasn't sure where I was going with it, which is super exciting. So I knew that I wanted to draw and paint onto objects, and I knew that I wanted to talk about something, you know, like a social problem. But I didn't know exactly what the imagery was going to be, and so I started figuring that out as I went. And I didn't know what the installation would really look like. And, you know, at some point I knew that I would be painting on the wall because I wanted to have an image, you know, this sort of wallpaper effect. But I didn't know until I went to the gallery, like, which color I was going to use. So I tried to, you know, leave some open-ended things within my working practice. Sometimes, though, I'm on the complete opposite spectrum. So I'll do a ton of research. I collect a lot of imagery. I make collages in Photoshop. I will project a collage or a small sketch that I do. I'll project it, you know, large on the wall. So then you can make it like 30 feet long.
Right.
And so it just depends on like what I want.
So when you project, Hollis, do you just you start to kind of trace it out? You get a feel for it, or you just kind of draw on top of that projection?
Yeah, I usually use the projection just as sort of an outline,
uh-huh.
And then that way I can go back, because I really do enjoy drawing, like the process of drawing and figuring out stuff as you're drawing. And so I try to give myself, even if I'm using a projection of a collage, for instance. I try to leave enough open, like I don't really know what it's going to look like at the end, like how dark it will be or how textured it might be, like all that happens in the process of making. So I think you can have a little bit of structure which helps you get to that giant scale. You know, do a lot of small sketches and see what happens when you blow them up larger. Could be really interesting.
Well, Hollis, thank you so much. I think that about concludes our time. We want to say again, on behalf of NKU, how proud we are of you and what you do and your career. Keep on making excellent work and keep on being Winchell at your university again. And so we'll say goodbye, take care, and we'll keep following
you. Thank you.
All right, bye-bye. See ya.